Have your way, God. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 1. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 12. I want everybody to stand all over the house for the honoring of the word of God. Amen. Amen. Stand if you can. Praise God. Praise God. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 1. When you found it, shout, I got it. If you don't have it yet, say, I'm still looking. If you don't have a Bible, say, Lord, help me. Look up. The Lord has helped you. Colossians 1 and 1. Paul, let's read it together. 1, 2, 3. And by the and read it again. Paul and by the and one more time. And by the and now go to 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 12. 1 Timothy 4 and 12. The Bible says, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Verse 13. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Verse 14. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. Verse 15. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them that your progress may be evident to all. Verse 16. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Verse 12, let no man despise your youth, but be an example. The word be an example means become a pattern. And so for a few moments today, I want to talk about becoming a pattern. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you for a fresh anointing all over this place. God, I cannot do your work without your power. All over this room, we apprehend the atmosphere. We stir anticipation all over this place. Lift those hands. Father, I thank you that our eyes are open, our ears are open, and your spirit is moving in this place. God, now apprehend this moment, God, and let your glory be revealed. In the name of Jesus, I thank you for moving in this place. I come against every hindrance, every distraction. I thank you that deliverance is occurring, not just from, but to. You're not just going to take somebody out of, you're going to bring somebody into. So, Father, have your way in this place right now in the name of Jesus. Break somebody's limitations off. Break the mold off of somebody's mind in the name of Jesus. Have your way in this place. We pull down strongholds, cast down imaginations and high things that exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Edify and build up your people. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Open up your mouth and shout hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on, come on. Shout hallelujah if you're ready. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are in a series entitled Made for More. Everybody say made for more. We believe we're made for more. And so we've begun primarily digging into the book of Colossians. And God gave me an instruction in that series. And he said, I want you to preach it as long as I have you in it. Amen. And I'll tell you when not to. Amen. And so God has been digging in. And as we have been studying the word, it's amazing because I planned to be way beyond this point right now. But God keeps highlighting stuff to me out of verse 1. The farthest I've gotten so far, I read to 14, but I haven't preached past 2. Amen. Because God is saying something, and there's something he wants to emphasize, and it's okay because we're just going to move with the timing of God. All right? So I'm talking about becoming a pattern. Everybody say, this word is for me. It's for me. All right? So we're talking about how this series is about spiritual growth. It's about you growing in God. Because when you get saved, you don't get saved just to sit up until you go to heaven. You get saved and God has a destination in mind. Many people are trying to discover what their destiny is, and they think their destiny is a place. They think their destiny is something they will have. Your destiny is not the house you're going to live in or the car you'll drive. Okay, the Bible says in Romans 8:29 that he has predestined us, that is marked out beforehand, that we would be conformed to the image of his son. Conform means I was not originally in that form, but he's going to shape me until I take on the form of the image of Christ. So when I get saved, God's not done working on me. I am not saved and then at the finished state, but I am on my way. All right, so personally, I am on my way to the image of Christ. That's where I'm growing. Look at somebody and say, I'm growing somewhere. Okay, I'm going to be like Christ in my ways. I'm going to be like Christ in my works. Okay, here's what you got to get. Now, that God doesn't want you to spend your whole life trying not to do the stuff you used to do. God has something so much better planned for you. He's trying to get you. He wants your new problem to be trying to figure out how to do what he called you to do. Look at somebody and say, I need new problems. Not trying not to do what I used to do. I want to wrestle now to try to figure out, God, how do I do what I have the potential to do? And your potential, according to the word of God, is to do the stuff Jesus did and greater. Follow me. That's where God is trying to take you personally. Everybody say personally. That's where I'm going. The image of Christ. Everybody say, I'm going to be like Jesus before it's all said and done. I'm going to think like Jesus. I'm going to respond like Jesus. My attitude's going to be like Jesus. The anointing on my life is going to be like Jesus. Tell somebody I'm growing somewhere. So individually, I'm growing to be like Jesus. Corporately, I'm a part of the church. The church is growing according to Ephesians 4 and verse 13. We are growing until we take on the full measure of the stature of Christ. Okay, so God wants the church to be like Jesus. In other words, another thing he said, I'm building you and I'm trying to make you, according to Ephesians 2:22, a habitation in the Spirit. In other words, God is connected you to the person beside you and he wants to make us a dwelling place for him. Here's what that means, that whenever we gather together, God wants his presence here to be so strong that whatever Jesus would have done if he was there, it happens because we're here. Jesus, look at somebody say, we're growing somewhere. And one of the greatest problems I see in many of our lives is not that we started too low, is that we aim too low. Because God doesn't care where you start, because he knows how he has the power to finish. He knows how to take you. But if your aim is too low, you will limit yourself to what God can do in and through your life. So one of the greatest challenges that I have giving you the word of God is to stretch your thinking beyond where you are so that you can see God has more. Look at somebody, say, God has more for me. And I want everything he has for me. Push your neighbor, shout, I want everything he's got for me. All right. So personally, I'm growing to the image of Christ. Corporately, I'm a part of the local church. All right. And we are growing into the measure of the fullness of the stature of Christ. That's where we're growing together. Two things we said, if you're going to grow in God, two things you need. Who remembers what they are? Right leadership and? Right fellowship. You got to have right fellowship because you need people around you who want to go and want to grow where you want to go and grow. All right? You don't need people around you who are contradicting the steps you're trying to make in God. Now, I shared this in early service. I want to share it again in this one. One of the greatest litmus tests of, or one of the greatest ways you measure the right fellowship in your life is, what is it producing in you? Look at somebody say, what are your relationships producing? Okay. See, fellowship, if I'm rolling with you, there ought to be something about you that strengthens me. Okay? And one of the greatest ways I can measure it is, every now and then, if I'm in the right fellowship, God ought to show up while we're hanging out. Oh, God. Every now and then, I ought to get around you, glory to God, and we get to talking, and all of a sudden, God takes over the conversation, and you begin to speak into my life, and I begin to speak into your life, and we leave the conversation sharpened. But I am in wrong fellowship if every time I leave you, I feel grieved, and I feel like I heard something I shouldn't have heard, or I said something I shouldn't have said. It is saying to me, I'm in the wrong fellowship, because when I'm in the right fellowship, it ought to cause me to grow. I ought to be better. If only thing about you is that you're a good family man, then hanging around you ought to make me a better family man. It ought not make me despise my family. Are you in the house with me? Okay, if you're hanging out with them and they don't ever want to go home, they don't ever want to be around their family, their wife, and every other woman's got something that their wife don't have, you need to run for your life, because they're going to mess you up. Sisters, come on. If they got smart mouths, foul mouths, bad attitudes, and all they want to do is turn up, that's not good fellowship for you. Because watch this, association brings about assimilation. Don't consistently hang around anybody if you don't want to carry what they got. Because see, if you're not careful, all it takes, see, you don't understand, words are seeds. And so if I hear the wrong words too much, they plant seeds in my mind. And all of a sudden, seeds become trees. And I'm trying to figure out, why am I bearing this kind of fruit? It's because you kept entertaining that kind of seed. You can't entertain adulterous seed and don't grow an adulterous tree. Y'all don't want to say nothing to me in here. You can't hang around lying seeds and not grow a lying tree. I wish I had to. You can't grow. You can't plant angry seeds and not grow an angry tree. What kind of seed are you putting in me? I got to guard my heart, because out of it flows the issue of my life. And I got to be careful who I call friends, because if I call you my friend, that means I have given you access to a place in my heart. Everybody else may be an associate, but if I ever call you friend, it's because you have gained a particular place of access. And I got to be careful who I give access to my heart, because my heart is the control center of my life, and everything that happens in my life flows out of my heart. And that's why, let me take it a step further, you got to be careful who gets your ear, because whoever gets your ear gets your heart. They get the wrong stuff planted in your mind. That stuff get down in your heart, and then you're trying to wrestle with stuff, and you're trying to cut off branches when the issue is it's already taken root. You got to begin to deal with stuff. So my fellowship is critical. I cannot hang. See, every now and then, there at least got to be one thing about you that motivates me in the right direction. We all may be working on stuff together, but let me tell you something. I ain't going to be staying in the same situation forever. And you're not even making any efforts to get out of what you're in. I'm not trying to say I'm better than you. I'm just saying we can't hang. Like, we could be cool if I see you somewhere, I speak to you, and we could talk for 5 minutes, but I ain't inviting you over. No, I don't want you to ride with me. And no, I don't want to come over. And no, I don't want to borrow anything. And no, I don't, because we don't fellowship like that. Because I got to be careful who I fellowship with because of where I'm trying to go. And sometimes I understand how it is. I'm a person that if I believe in you to the end. Like, if I ever just say I ain't got nothing to do with you, it's really bad. Really, really bad. Because God didn't give up on me. So I just don't write folks off. If I believe, and whatever God shows me about you, I believe you. I believe it. And you can do stuff that don't look like what he showed me about you. I'll still believe what he told me until he tells me otherwise. Until I finally realize, you know what? He don't even want it. Then I still might fight you for 5 more years to get you to try to wake up and see what God sees. Right? So I say that because I understand what it's like when you're loyal. You're a loyal person. You're like, man, I can't just, man, I've been rolling with them since preschool. But they still act like they in preschool. You still act like you in preschool. I can't not graduate and get my diploma because you want to play in the dirt. Like, I love you, but we're not even on the same playground. Matter of fact, where I am, we don't even have reset. I wish I had some help here. Y'all don't want to talk back to me. Come on, there's certain people in your life, if they always on recess, bro, you it's time to go. Because you got to have the right fellowship. But not only do you have to have the right fellowship, you got to have the right leadership. You got to have the right leadership in your life. Everybody, every single person on this planet needs a leader. You got to have a leader. I don't care if you're a pastor, I don't care what you need a leader. You need godly influence in your life. You need somebody who can pour into you, somebody who can correct you, somebody who can aim you, somebody you can run decisions by. Amen. And watch this, God will send different people in your life to fulfill different roles. There's some people in your life that the role they're going to play is because of what their gifting is. You know, they're going to be the one that helps you get your marriage together. Amen? They're going to be the ones. Now watch this. Be careful who you say can't tell you nothing. Man, I read something the other day. I read so much stuff sometimes that the Holy Ghost just uses it to give me self-control. Because I had to roll away. Because I think of like 50 scriptures at one time. Like, pap, 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 pap. That's wrong because of da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And I just roll away because if I bring it up, then it's going to become a big argument and ain't even worth it. But they said, I can't listen to such and such because they talk to such and such. And my issue is you don't even know why they talk to such and such. So I'm saying, well, I ain't about to listen to nobody who is friends with Oprah. Listen, I don't agree with most of the stuff that Oprah believes in. But somebody's got to get close enough to share the gospel. Somebody got to get close enough to her to tell her the truth. You know, they call Jesus the friend of sinners. Because he would go eat at a tax collector's house. He said, because I didn't go for what they were serving, I came for what I was bringing. Y'all don't want to help me here. Jesus knew. Now watch this. I'm not talking about fellowship. I'm talking about assignment now. There's a difference between fellowship and discipleship. Jesus was coming in, getting ready to bring transformation. So she's saying, well, I can't listen to so-and-so because, well, you know what? Balaam would have died if he hadn't listened to a donkey. God can save your life through a mule. And sometimes what God will do, thank you, Holy Ghost, is God will put what you need in a package you don't prefer to see how bad you want him. See, everybody wants certain people to say stuff to you, but they don't want other people to say certain to. Somebody else can tell you the same thing that a certain person could tell you, but if the other person tells you that, you act like you didn't hear it, and a certain person tell you, all of a sudden... That's the best thing I ever heard in my life. I've never seen it on this wise. I just told you that 5 minutes ago. But the issue is, you dishonor my vessel. And if, oh God, if you can't honor the vessel, you can't hear the voice. Right in the house. So God sends you leadership. And leadership is so critical because sometimes God has sent you leadership in your life to fill in gaps. God has sent leadership to fill in gaps. To be honest, there are some times when you needed your parents to do certain stuff that they didn't do. Sometimes you need them to do stuff that they couldn't do. Sometimes you wanted them to do stuff that they didn't know they needed to do. So either way it goes, you refuse to be bitter. You're too old to keep blaming folks. Once you hit 18, 19, and old, once you're old enough to blame somebody, you're 17 years old, I wouldn't be this way if my mama hadn't. Well, you're old enough now to take responsibility for your life. Okay, maybe she didn't. Well, now if you realize that what you are now is not what you ought to be, rather than spend the rest of your life pointing back to what they didn't do in the first 17 years, make up your mind to find out what you ought to be, find out where you ought to get it from, find out what you need, find out what you're missing, and ask God to send somebody who's carrying what they don't have. And when God sends them, don't ever take for granted what your parents did give you. See, I don't care. There's no excuse for you to ever allow yourself to be comfortable with disrespecting your mama. If nothing, I don't care if she never said anything to you since birth. She went through 9 months of carrying you and however long of labor to get you here. So she deserves respect for the rest of your life, if nothing more than the fact that she did that. And the day you get bad enough to decide she don't deserve respect, then say, I don't deserve to live then. Because if it had not been for her going through that pain, you wouldn't have been here. And let me say this, because I know it's a sensitive subject, but it's true anyhow. I don't care how frustrated you may be at your father in what he did or did not do. If he was used to be the carrier that got you here, then you ought to just give God the glory for the fact that he did what he could. Maybe that's all he could do. Maybe God had to move him so he wouldn't mess me up. I wish I had some help here. Because see, there's some folks, if they're around you too long, you worse off. So you better say, man, I just thank God for that dude. You know what I'm saying? I praise God for him. He did all he could. But I'm going to go on now and live my life to the glory of God. Because even the Bible says, if my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. My Bible declares he'll take the solitary and he'll put them in families. See, if you are somebody who don't have anybody in your family trying to live right, you really ought to love your church. You really ought to be connected to the house of God, because at least I got some believers there. And guess what? We just like family. Ain't nobody perfect. We got a couple of them. You know, they got some stuff going on. But we family. We family. We family. Up, down, in, out, whatever you got going on, we'll be here together. Are you in the house with me? Let me just tell you something. Let me tell you something. In the midst of all the frustration of it, however you feel, if you keep looking at people and earthly stuff, you'll never see what God could do in your life. You never see. And see, I want you to be a person who, whatever people contribute in your life, you're grateful. Because nobody really has to do anything for you. So if they do, I want you to be grateful. You see, I don't have to disrespect what got me here in order to go where I'm going from here. See, there are a lot of people. See, I'm very grateful. God has blessed me with some great leadership in my life, but I'm the man I am because of my father. At the core of all, I'm the man I am. I have the values I have. I value family the way I do because of my father. That's the bottom line. God has sent great spiritual leaders into my life, but I'm the man I am at the core of who I am. I value what I value because of him. Amen. God has used great men of God to open doors for me. But my preaching ministry has grown because, and people say, well, Pastor, you really, really know the Bible. No, you need to know Pastor Gus Walker because he is a walking Bible. Y'all want to help me here? I didn't learn the Bible when I went to Bible college. I learned more about it. But the man who walked in that word and he could quote that thing, he could take one word. He used to preach a message called If. And I mean, he'll just wreck your life preaching about if. So when I get ready to go to Bible college, I don't disrespect him. I honor him and I keep on going and I receive who else God brings into my life to grow the next part of my life. But it's honor at every season and you don't have to dishonor one to honor another. Some of y'all are cutting off your blessing because you're disrespecting what got you here. Y'all don't want to help me in this house. Y'all better help me in this. I'm preaching better than you're shouting. Some of you trying to figure out why stuff won't work out because you are cursing the very thing that blessed you to get to where you are. I don't care. I know it had some issues, but David said, I will not touch the Lord's anointed. He may be trying to kill me, but I'll never try to kill the thing. Saul gave me my first job in the kingdom. Saul may hate my guts now, but I'll never hate him. If all I can do is look back on the day that he brought me in to play my instrument, then that's what I'll remember. I'll never be the one spreading a negative word about somebody who helped me get to where I am. Go get grown and get blessed and act brand new. Come on. I don't care if it was a little church and one but three or four people in that church from time to time. If that's where you came from, praise God for where you came from, because you know God because of those little three mothers in the church that prayed you through. I wish I had some help here. If it was nobody in your family but grandmama, you know, daddy wasn't saved. Mama was in and out. But grandma helped me. You better give God praise for grandmama. You know, when you get blessed, grandmama ought to get blessed. We live in a culture of disrespect and dishonor. And it is disgusting. Dishonor will disconnect you from blessing every time. It's okay to disagree with authority in your life, but you don't have to be disrespectful to disagree. There are times when you may disagree, when you should humbly submit whatever your question may be. And then there are other times when you just need to pray, because there may be something you don't see yet. And sometimes we look at people, you know, see, some of y'all didn't understand mama till you became mama. Y'all don't know me. Well, if I was mama, I wouldn't have hit me like that. And I wonder, and then now all of a sudden now you got your arm? Your arm moving directions. Come on. You better tell the truth. Be careful the stuff you say when you're on the sideline watching the game. Talking about, well, if I was them, I would have done it. You didn't see the play unfolding. You didn't see what I saw. And then everybody in the stands think they know everything about everything. But wait till you have to grind this thing out and walk in my shoes and then talk about what you would do if you were me. There was stuff I thought I knew about leadership till I became one. I was talking to a friend of mine who we were talking about what's going on in Baltimore. We were saying, well, I think they all do this. I said, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm giving them people a lot of grace. I said, because leading during crisis is different than talking about leading during crisis. All that stuff happening, that ain't happening to you. You sitting on the other side of the computer acting like an expert. You're not having having to deal with the egos and the attitudes and the turf wars, and I'm mad about this, and then the secret agendas that people have up their sleeve, and you got to navigate through how to bring God into all this drama when people don't even want to hear about God because stuff getting burned down. See, some of us, oh God, can't glean from people because we're so busy trying to bring them down to where we are. We're so busy trying to disqualify why we ought to respect them. Hey man, just like I am. Younger than me. I've been longer than you. How you the boss? Because they the boss. And you not the boss. Well, if I was the boss, I'd do such and such. Well, you ain't the boss. So you can't even do such and such. Well, I know this and this and this. Well, that don't matter right now, does it? I'm really just trying to help us. Because you can't receive from leadership you don't respect. You can't receive from your mom and dad if you don't respect them. You can't receive from a pastor if you don't respect them. And you have to then, when you see authority, you cannot look at authority just for the person or the man themselves. You have to see that God is into authority. It's his idea. Authority is God's idea. See, when Paul comes in, here in the text, he's got a young man by the name of Timothy. The Bible says, Paul, an apostle, Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and our brother Timothy. And as I was studying, God began to arrest me with that thought about Timothy. Because Timothy is a perfect example of what God's trying to do in your life. He's trying to grow you. And when he wants to grow you, he assigns leadership to you to help you get there. Watch this. This is going to help you. See, Timothy was the son. His father was a Greek. Many believe his father was not a believer. He was a Greek. His mother and his grandmother were believers, but he had not seen a man in his family line serving God. Then God sends Paul because he's got a desire to do something that he hadn't seen anybody in his family successfully do. Are you following me here? So God sends Paul, and Paul in Acts 16 takes Timothy under his wing. And one of the first things he does, because he's a good leader, is he circumcises Timothy, meaning he cuts off the foreskin. He cuts off the foreskin, why? Because he knew he was a Greek and there were going to be Jews. Follow me. The Jews would have given Timothy a hard time if Paul had not circumcised, because the first thing a father wants to do is help you avoid unnecessary trouble. Your calling gonna get you in enough trouble anyway. Let me remove people's arguments against you. That's why you need leaders in your life that can tell you the stuff that'll keep you out of unnecessary drama. There's certain things you ought not do because you're already gonna get fought for your faith. Don't get fought for your foolishness. So Paul cuts back the foreskin and he begins to let Timothy walk with him. And whenever God lets you walk with leadership, never take it for granted. Never take it for granted when you have access to leadership in your life. Don't take it for granted. Don't become somebody who's so familiar that you don't let them bless you. But when you're walking, make sure you're learning. Make sure you're gleaning. Because good leaders will teach you how to get in position for your destiny. You see, when Paul takes on Timothy, Timothy starts off as a child. Everybody say a child. He grows him up and sees him become a young man. And then here he's about to call him to be a father. Everybody say child, young man, father. Child, young man, father. 1 John 2 says, I wrote to you as children because basically you've come to know Jesus Christ, so you're a child. He said, I wrote to you young men because you have overcome the evil one. And he says, I wrote to you fathers because you've known him from the beginning. Let me break it down. I wrote to you children because children are people who just got saved. I wrote to you young men because now you're at a point where you're learning how to overcome stuff and you're learning how to get victory. victory. He said, but when you become a father is when you've developed a history with God. You've known him from the beginning. I wish I had some help here. Look at your neighbor and say, God is getting me ready to be a pattern for somebody's life. Are y'all with me? All right, everybody say, help us, Pastor. All right, good, 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 good. Here we go. In Colossians, he's writing to Colossae, and he's trying to get them growing in Christ. They're up against stuff. The world is coming in, trying to corrupt them, trying to contaminate their faith. And here he makes the statement, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother. And I struggle with that because in 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, he called Timothy his son. Philippians 2, he's writing, describing Timothy. He said, he served with me like a son does with his father. But here in Colossians 1 and 1, he says, Timothy, our brother. He is now acknowledging the fact, number one, that we are brothers in Christ, even though I'm his leader, right? But number two, he's given dignity to the fact that this young man is growing. And here's what he's saying. He's saying he may be young, but y'all better start listening to him. What he's doing is he's setting him up so when it's time for Timothy to take over and Paul to go, they'll know that Timothy has credibility and he can be trusted. But watch this. If you never connect and submit yourself to any leadership, who's going to speak for you? I was around some men of God, and they told me, they said flat out, these are like guys older in the faith, generals in the faith, and they made a statement to me. They said, we're going to be very frankly and honest with you. The first thing we want to know when somebody tells us to invite you to our church or somebody, we want to know, who are you connected to? Who are you submitted to? Because it tells me what I can expect. And if can't nobody speak for you, it means you can't be trusted. Oh, I wish I had some hip. Come on now. Come on now. Let me just bring it down your street. If nobody wants to be a reference on your resume. You know, because I'm careful about stuff like that. I'm not signing off on that. I'll decline. No comment. I ain't going to give you a bad one. I just ain't going to be lying. They asked me to introduce somebody. He was coming to town. He was pretty famous, very well-known guy. And they said, we want you to introduce him. And they felt like they were doing me this great honor. And I knew they were really trying to honor me and give me that opportunity. But I said, what's his platform? What is he going to be talking about? I said, because if I'm going to get up and introduce him, that means I endorse him. And if I endorse him and he get up talking crazy, that makes me look bad. He go back out of town where he lives and I got to fix the mess in the town I love. They said, well, we didn't think about that. So they didn't let me introduce. I still went to it. He did a great job. We went to dinner afterwards. I thought he did a good job, you know. But I still didn't feel bad for not introducing him. Because I thought, no. If I ever put my name on it, I want to make sure it's credible and it can be trusted. And I want to know who can speak up for you. Who have you given access to your life that they can say, see, this is my problem. Not that you fall, but who do you go to when you fall? Who are you accountable to? You don't just mess up in ministry, go sit down for 3 days in your mind and get back up and do. Who are you accountable to? Who can say you've changed? If the apostle Paul needed somebody to speak for him, Barnabas said, listen, man, guys, I know he got a messed up history, but I believe he's the real deal. If Jesus needed John the Baptist to speak for him, you need somebody to speak for you. Timothy needed Paul. Watch this. Elisha needed Elijah. Who can speak for you? Are y'all in the house with me? Y'all all right? Holy Spirit, help me to maximize the moments that I have. He said, Timothy, I'm getting you. See, right leadership helps you get in position. See, watch this, man. There are doors you can't open for yourself. Somebody say, well, God, if God want to open the door, God will open the door that no man can shut. You know whose hands he going to use? to turn the knob. Somebody you better not disrespect. He's going to use somebody's hands to open the door. Oh, God, are y'all all right? Because this is good to me. Like, we all tired. I'll go home and preach to myself. I'll have a good time. Here's what I want you to see. God, watch this, because he loves you, will put people in your life. How many have ever can admit, Pastor, there's some stuff I know God has for me, but I don't know how to get to it. Like, there's some stuff you know in your heart. Man, I know it, like I know my name. I know God's got it for me. But I don't even know how to function if I get it. I don't know what I ought to do. Watch this. There's some rooms you go into that there's an etiquette. There are certain unwritten codes that you don't do. And you need somebody that can tell you when you get in the room, don't do this, don't say that, just get in there and be quiet. Y'all don't want to help me in here. See, you need some people that can help talk you to the next level. Every Ruth needs a Naomi. You see, Naomi, Ruth was married to Naomi's son. Her son died, and the other sister-in-law, Orpah, said, I'm going back home. Ruth said, hold on, my life has been different since I met Naomi. And Orpah can go back, but wherever you go, Naomi, I'm going. Your God is going to be my God. Your people are going to be my people. You see, the real test of you as a leader, as a follower, is not can you follow your leader when they're on the mountain, but can you track with them through the valley? I wish I had some help here. Can you bless your leader when it seemed like your leader can't bless you? See, there are people who connect with fellowships and connect with people because of what they think they can do for them. I thank God that I'm not just around people based upon what I think they can do, because everybody can sense an opportunist. You can sense when somebody just want to be around you to get you, to get them somewhere. But if you love me, I need you to love me. If I don't take you anywhere. Come on, preach. Preach to your neighbor. Preach to your neighbor. Say, neighbor, do you love me? Do you love me more than these? Do you love me? Do you love me, Peter? Feed my sheep. Do you love me, Peter? Do you love me more than these? Are you in the house with me? You see, and so Orpah goes back. Ruth says, no, I'm staying. Well, Naomi is in a bitter place. She was in a blessed place when she met her, but she was in a bitter place as she followed her. So she followed her, and even though the leader was bitter, she still had something to bless her. When they got back, because see, what Naomi had was Naomi had a relationship. She knew Boaz. See, some of y'all sisters trying to find Boaz, but you won't listen to Naomi. Come on, you trying to find Boaz. I'm going to find my Boaz this year. Well, you better ask, where's Naomi? Because Naomi is going to tell you how to get his attention. Naomi told Ruth, I want you to go out to the field. It's a field that's owned by Boaz. When you get out in the field, just start working. Just work with the rest of the servants and help out a little bit. Because the right leadership will get you in the right field. See, sometimes, can you serve in the field before you own the field? Y'all don't. She gets in the field, Boaz discovers the Boaz says, man, you're just honorable. And he leaves her nuggets behind. You see, watch this. Let me just drop this for somebody. This will help you. This will bless you in life. Wherever God has shown you to go, at least get in the field and start gathering nuggets. Wherever you're going, if it's business, get in the field and start getting nuggets. If it's athletics, get in the field and start gaining the nuggets of people who already are where you're going. Leadership gets you in position. And watch this. When you really get connected to leadership, people are going to talk about you. People, I know some people talk about y'all. Why y'all go over there to that church? Why y'all go over there? Especially if you might be a little bit older. Why you go over there and listen to that old young man? Why you do all that? Because it's the field God told me to go to. And I'm gleaning in the field. And I'm growing in the field. And God's raising me up in the field. Because I ain't caught up in the person. I ain't caught up in the man. I ain't caught up in the vessel. I'm looking for God. And when I walk into that atmosphere and I sense God, that's all I need to know. All right, let me hurry. Here we go. So Timothy is setting him. Paul is setting Timothy up. He's getting ready to hand over Ephesus to him. And when he sets him over Ephesus, over the church, you see, watch this. When you're a real son, when you're a real follower, God will hand stuff off to you. I didn't have to go start a church. Because I was a son. So when God was ready to send me to pastor, he sent me. And the man before me had already spoken over me. And he said, listen, he said when I was in college, and I wasn't even sure if I wanted to pastor. He said, when Minister RJ gets done with school, if he wants to come back here and take over the church, I retire and let him pastor. But people not going to speak for you if they can't trust you. People say, and then some people say, well, you didn't have it as hard as I had it because you didn't have start. Well, I was a son. Don't get mad at me for that. Sonship brings inheritance. So he hands Ephesus over to him. And then in this letter, he's writing to him in 1 Timothy 4. He's writing to him. And here's the deal. Check this, guys. Check this. 5 minutes, I think we can land this plane. Timothy, whose father was a Greek, wasn't even a believer. Now he's a bishop in the church. He's a bishop in the church. His father wasn't even a believer. Because God can do stuff in your future that don't match what happened in your past. Because when that anointing gets on your life, it starts changing you. That's why when God's getting ready to change your life, he'll start changing your circles. I'm preaching better than you're shouting, but I feel the Holy Ghost. I said when God gets ready there to do something new in your life, he'll put you around different people that make you think different. And they eat different and they act different and they talk different. And you really don't even know how to do it yet. So God will make you quiet for a season till you learn how to operate at your next level. I wish I had some help in here. Look at your neighbor and say, where I'm going doesn't look like where I've been, but I sure am going. I'm going. I'm a little scared, but I'm going. I'm nervous, but I'm going. I don't even know how to get there and everything that's going to happen when I do, but I'm going. I'm going in God. God, I'm going to be who you call me to be. I don't know how to be all that I see in my spirit that I'm going to be, but I'm going to trust you, and I'm going to let you lead me all the way. Somebody push your neighbor, say, he's going to get you there. I feel something pushing me here. Somebody tell your neighbor, God's going to get me there. Watch this. He says, Timothy, over Ephesus. And he says, listen, not only is your father not even a believer, so I'm going to make you a pattern to the rest of the men who are going to come in your family after you. But there's never been a bishop in the church this young. See, normally elders in the church were elders because they were elders. And they were older. But this one, son, I just see something in you. I prophesy over your life. God's about to, in you, as you're working in companies, wherever, whatever field you're in, I declare over your life, let God begin to see people who will take you under their wing because they just see something in you. See, every one of us needs somebody that can see something, that can see a treasure in the middle of all the trash. Every one of us needs somebody that can see a potential in the midst of raw material. Everybody, I don't just see the diamond when I'm shining, but see a diamond in the rough. See that I got potential. Pull me out. I need somebody willing to dust me off. I need somebody willing to help me get polished. I need somebody that can believe in me when I'm under pressure. Don't just believe in me when I get there, because then you a fan and I'm not impressed. But I need somebody that'll walk with me while I'm developing. Tell your neighbor, are you the one? Can you handle the pressure I'm going through? I don't need you faking with me. I need to know that if it gets hotter right now, that you're still gonna stay.
I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here.
He's youngest elder in the church. So Paul tells him, look, son, don't you let anybody despise you because you're young. The word despise means to see as little, to think little or nothing of. We say it like this: don't let nobody sleep on you. Don't let anybody write you off because you're young. Watch this. Come on, church. Come on, church. I heard somebody were telling, they were talking about churches, and they had asked somebody, you know, somebody had moved into town, and they were looking for a church, and they said, well, you know, the older, more distinguished people, they go to this church, and such and such, they go to this church, and the young folks, they go to KVIC. All y'all young folks over 60, make some noise. Come on. Watch this. Now, I it don't bother me. I understand it, you know. I praise God for that. I want to reach as many young people as we can. Glory to God. I'm really not offended by that in that regard. But I do understand that some people have a negative connotation in doing that. And the thing is, and what you got to understand, and you got to let it fuel you to grow up. Because basically what some people want to believe is that is they want to keep you playing over in the kiddie sandbox. I went to a meeting, somebody said, well, I just had a meeting with a group of pastors. And I looked around, I said, well, I wasn't in that group of pastors. We said, we're going to do something for the young people. And da-da-da-da, and I had a meeting with a group of pastors. And I said, well, I wasn't in that group of pastors. I do more stuff for young folks than half these folks around here that you probably had in the meeting. I'm just telling you the truth. That's what I was thinking myself. I ain't say it out loud. I was going to be respectful, but in my mind, I'm thinking to myself, okay. Anyway. There comes a point, though, when you got to decide, no, I may be young, but I'm not going to be immature. So watch what he says. Let no man despise the fact that you're young. He said, in other words, don't let them use it against you. He said, because really they're trying to figure out how I put that on y'all when it didn't have anything to do with you and everything to do with God. He says, so what I want you to do is I want you to be an example. And here's the word that God gave me for KVIC. He said, I want you to become a pattern. In other words, he said, since they're going to be looking, give them something to look at. Come on. He said, I want to grow you to the point that in your word, you are a pattern. In other words, church, it's time for you to talk like it when you leave here.
Because if we come here and keep having church, but you keep going places cussing folks out, they're going to keep doubting what God is doing in your life. Y'all don't want to help me here. He said the way you talk ought to be an example for people. Become a pattern by the way you hold your tongue. You got to get to a point where I can't post that. I cannot post that. I refuse to post that. That's last year. I graduated out of that. I ain't even living there no more. I'm in my word. You got to come to the point that when you speak now, you want it to glorify God. You want it to magnify God. Come on. I don't want to say nothing that's not going to lift up God. I don't want to say anything that's not going to bring glory to His name. Look at somebody say, become a pattern. Become a pattern in your conduct, he tells Timothy. He said, act like you're on another level. Walk differently. Talk differently. Show people how they ought to be living. Be a pattern in your spirit. Be a pattern with your faith. Let me preach to somebody. God's about to make your faith an example to somebody else. God's getting ready to do something through your testimony that's going to show somebody else that if God could do it for you, He can do it for them. Somebody shout, become a pattern. Keep helping me. I'm on my way out of here. Tell your neighbor, become a pattern. He said, till I come, keep reading the word, keep teaching the word, and keep breaking it down. I wish I had some help here. And then he said, do not neglect the gift that is in you with the through prophecy and the laying on of hands. Help me, Holy Ghost. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, there's a reason for laying on of hands. You see, the laying on of hands was the transmission of power. The Bible declares that in Genesis 48, Israel laid hands on his sons. And when he laid hands on his sons, a blessing was released. Deuteronomy 34 says that Moses laid hands on Joshua. Therefore, Joshua had the spirit of wisdom and understanding. Because when hands are laid, a blessing is transferred. Some people say, well, I don't know if I believe in all that laying on of hands. Well, don't believe in gifts and don't believe in impartation. But if you believe that a blessing... You see, the Bible declares that Joshua had wisdom because Moses laid hands. Let me break down what that means. What Moses had to get over time, you get in a moment because he laid his hands. And that's why Paul said to Timothy, don't lay hands on anybody suddenly. He said, because when you lay hands on folks, you are identifying them for leadership. And he said, you have gone through too much to pass it out too lightly. You have been through too much struggle to give it to any and everybody. But when you lay your hand, put it on somebody who's ready to run with it. And I want to know, are there 30 people in Kingdom Vision that say, Pastor, I'm ready to run. I need a fresh anointing because I am going somewhere. Just three steps further. First step, he said there was a gift you got when you got a prophecy. In other words, Michael, when you got a word, you got power and you got potential. The word was not just a word. The word was carrying something. Tell your neighbor, I got a word. And because I got a word, I'm carrying something. tell your neighbor, I'm carrying something. And God told me to tell you about 30 people in Kingdom Vision. You cannot neglect it. Let me say it this way. Don't sit on the gift. Don't spend another year not doing what he told you, but stir up the gift of God that is in you through the laying on of my hands. Some of you in here have had too many hands laid for you not to go to the next level. You've got to go high. You've got to go up. You've got to grow. You've got to become. Feel this right here. I said, I feel this right here. Turn around and touch three people. I say, I got a lot riding on me. I said, touch three people and tell them, I got a lot riding on me. I got a lot riding on me. My family is riding on me. My future is riding on me. I got an assignment. And it's riding on me. My church is riding on me. I've got something to do for the Lord. Excuse me, I feel the Holy Ghost. Tell your neighbor, I got a lot riding on me. Listen, 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 listen. He said, don't neglect the gift that's in you. Here's what's so powerful. I just saw this very clearly. You know, and when I point to leadership, I'm ultimately pointing to Christ. Because Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. It's never about looking to man. But God uses man to bless us. Listen, listen, listen. Watch this. The leaders in our lives. See, when he says hands were laid on you from the eldership, there was a transferring of blessing. There was an identification for leadership. Whenever someone was being set in office as a bishop, there were at least three people in place to lay hands on them. And then there was a presider. And the presider had authority to lay hands himself. So there was a time when Paul just laid his hands on Timothy himself. And then there was a time when the eldership surrounded him and everybody laid hands. And when that happened, imagine this. Everything that each one of them carried was imparted into a young man at one time. The reason you are going to do more than what you've seen is because you got more in you to start with. You hear me? He said, Timothy, there's a gift in you, and I know you're scared because you hadn't seen anybody else do it. That's why I'm calling you to be a pattern. Anybody in here got some stuff God put in your heart that you hadn't seen anybody do? Raise your hand. God wants to use you as a pattern. And you can't neglect that gift that's in you because it's a fire burning in you. And you can't keep trying to put that fire out. He said, now if you're gonna really grow this thing, you got to meditate on it. Meditate on that word.
Some of you got to get your assignment back on your mind. If you would just be honest, many of us in this room, sometimes I know life can rock you to sleep. Before you know it, 6 months, 7 months, 3 years have passed, and you've done nothing with what God told you. Am I preaching to anybody in this house? You just done nothing with it. But God wants to recall you to focus. He wants to say to you, man, meditate on what I said about you. Remember what I told you when you were 12? Remember what I revealed to you when you were 23? Meditate on it. Next thing he tells him in verse 15, he says, give yourself entirely to it. That's what I love. I love it right there. It literally means whatever God told you, it says be in those things. It means be fully consumed with whatever God told you. You got to be fully consumed with it. Fully consumed. Fully consumed. Am I talking about it to anybody in this house? All right. So give yourself entirely to it. He said, if you do, your progress will be evident to all. He said, Timothy, you won't even have to turn around and argue with people and tell them, I'm not young, blah, blah, blah. He said, it'll speak for itself. Your progress, because you gave yourself entirely to it. If you're called to do something, you ought to give yourself entirely to it. Learn everything you can about it so you can use it for the glory of God. If I'm called a pastor, I'm called a minister, I'm called to do, I have to give myself entirely to it. Put all my energy, my effort into it. I want you to think about this. Someone training for the Olympics. Months and years and hours. Getting up early, staying up late. Affecting their diet so they can be effective. Sometimes for a 10-second race. Whatever you've got is of eternal significance. How much are you going to put into it? Here's what the Lord told me. There's some people in this room that you feel like Timothy. It's like, God, I haven't had a pattern to show me. But I know that you want to make me a pattern. I want to make you something that people can look to and see God. If that's you in this room, wherever you are, I want you to get up from where you are. Come and meet me at this altar right now. Come. Come, come, come. Come. Come on, there's some Timothys in this room. Say, God, I believe in what you're telling me. I believe it. I'm going to make you a pattern. God said, I'm going to make you a pattern. I'm going to make you an example for people to look at. Say, that's how you ought to walk. That's how you ought to talk. That's how you ought to live. That's how you ought to do that. I'm going to make you a pattern. If that's you, come on, come on, come on. That's you, come on, come on, come on. Come on. Because sometimes God will show you stuff is so big that you know you can't do it yourself, and it almost intimidates you. But God never intended for you to do it without his help. You're going to do great things for God. I said you're going to do great things for God. As you lift your hands right now, I declare and I sense this from the Lord, your past is falling off. Your recognition, the prison of that thing, the chains of that are falling off of you right now. Let it go.